for Tony Dungy, who was a head coach and a defensive, you know, focused head coach, I think he's right. I think if you're preparing for Tom Brady, you obviously have to worry about his passing acumen, his ability to lead, like all those little things, but you're not worried about him, you know, going off script and crushing you with a 70-yard touchdown with his legs. You know what I mean? Or, you know, some of these other athletic traits that we now see in quarterbacks, or at least Tony Dungy was at the beginning of.
Or a 20-yard touchdown with his legs.
Yeah, exactly.
Forget about 70.
Or any rushing touchdown with his legs.
Except the quarterback sneak. That was it.
Tom Brady's got a bunch of them, I know, in his career, but they're one-yard plunges.
Yeah, yeah.
You know what I mean?
Yeah.
So, I mean, from a head coaching standpoint, like a game planning standpoint, it makes a lot of sense. And, you know, Tom Brady responded to this, obviously, which is in Tom Brady's way. He put up the AFC 2014 AFC participant.
Finalist.
Exactly.
I'm looking at it now. That's great.
That is awesome.
That's a Jedi social media move right
there. Total Jedi move. And you know he's doing it with a smile.
Yeah, yeah, yeah.
Because Tom knows he's the GOAT. He knows he's the man. He knows that, there, you know, he's got all the championships that any, you know, quarterback would want and been nine times and, you know, MVPs, all this other. We know he's the GOAT. But from a different lens, like, who are you scared of?
Yep.
It's a different conversation than who's the GOAT.
Let me tell you right now. I mean, if you want to even incorporate a few players from today.
Yeah.
Let's push this forward 5 years from now. All right, so you make sure that Mahomes is not, and I know this. I just say this to protect. You never know. We know he's not a one-year wonder. But like, let's just make sure he plays 5 years. Okay,
yeah, that's right.
So let's just push this 5 years forward. And you know, I believe if we're having this conversation in 5 years, that because we can incorporate other names from the past, I don't think that the way Dungy framed it, that Tom Brady's even in the top 20 or 25 of all time.
Yeah, just
I honestly don't.
For a guy to prepare for.
Dan Marino?
Yeah,
you gotta throw him. I know Marino didn't run, but Dan Marino had a rocket.
But I don't even think it's that. I think you know what Tom Brady was going to do. Like, they didn't, like, fool you and, you know, throw out these super innovative schemes and things like that. They ran the same things. They just executed to perfection.
Yep.
And so, like, preparing for that isn't hard. Stopping it is what was the hard thing. And so the way that Shannon Sharpe posed this question was unique because you never hear it asked that
way. Great way to pose it, Shannon.
But you can only do it to a coach, right? Or I mean, I guess maybe you could do it for, like, a middle linebacker or somebody who's a corner.
Yeah.
Like, who was your hardest receiver to prepare for?
Uh-huh.
Even though that still comes down to execution. Like, I think game planning encompasses an entire unit versus a guy. So a coach you can ask this question of, and it was a good way. And I think Tony Dungy's right. I think your instinct is right too. When it comes down to it, I think Lamar Jackson is infinitely harder to prepare for than probably any of the great quarterbacks that have been out there. Not
Josh Allen's. Josh Allen's moving in that direction.
Right. Not that
Randall Cunningham
or Josh Allen are, you know, all-time greats.
Yep.
To prepare for a guy
I
mean, hell.
I understand.
That's sleepless nights, man. I mean, the Giants have this weekend against Baltimore, and I did my weekly WFAN hit. That's our local affiliate here in New York because everybody's off on Friday. I did it today. I was like, I don't know how you prepare for this guy. I mean, you got to liberally substitute on defense because you get that one player who's like, man, all right, I'm gonna take a half play. Whew, catch my breath on this play. And next thing you know, he reverses field and is going 60 yards past you. You know what I mean?
We've seen it
it's
a lot.
All execution against guys like this and preparation.
And by the way, that's not even at least pertaining to your team's matchup this week. That's the wrong question because it's not about – that's the wrong way to attack it because it's not about stopping or how to even stifle Lamar. Let's say the Giants do that, which I don't think that they will. But if the Giants actually are able to suffocate Lamar Jackson, they better score some points.
Yeah, exactly.
How do you stop Lamar Jackson? Keep him off the field. How do you keep him off the field? Have some, you know, 10, 12, 15 play drives that punctuate in touchdowns.
That's right.
Exactly what the Giants have been doing. By the way, that is Shannon's Club Shay Shay podcast. Yeah, listen, if I'm going to put my – and I never do this. I'm going to put myself in the shoes of a head coach lying in his hotel room, right, the night before conference championship game. And lights are out. Work is done. Preparation, film, game plan installed. We're good. We're here. It's 11 o'clock at night. Lights are out. now it's time to wind down, and I got to get up early, and I got to coach. I would be saying to myself, oh, man, if I'm playing the Pats, all right, what does Belichick have up his sleeve? let me take you through. You'll like this. What does he have up my – what is he What is he going to do?
Am I getting an onside kick on the opening kickoff? Like stuff like that. Seriously.
Second half. What is he going to do that I don't see coming? So I'm more aware and more fearful of not being prepared for that than I am for Brady. Now let's keep it moving. If I'm laying – now, granted, 40 years ago, whatever it is, not 40, but 30 years ago, if I'm lying in my bed, no disrespect intended, and I'm getting ready for that same conference championship game and I'm playing the Broncos – I'm not lying on my bed saying, boy, what in the world is Dan Reeves going to do that's going to complicate my life that I don't see coming? I am fixated. I am having dreams about John Elway.
Yeah.
All right? And you could go down the list. And again, no disrespect to Tony Dungy. I don't think anybody, when he was a head coach, was sitting there saying, boy, we've had him on many times. I love Tony Dungy. But nobody, while they respect his acumen, of course, he's a Hall of Fame coach. He won a championship. Nobody's sitting there saying, boy, what is Tony going to do tomorrow that I don't see coming? It is how well is Peyton on his A game or his B-plus game? Because if he's on his A game, we ain't winning.
Yeah, how is he going to manipulate us at the line of scrimmage to make us think that we see what we think we don't see, we don't know what's coming, and all of a sudden he's got 70-yard touchdown.
Yep.
You know what I mean? Like
and
that.
Go down the list. McCarthy, Rodgers. You worried about McCarthy? Nope. You worried about Rodgers.
That's right.
Are you worried about Favre? You worried more about Brett Favre. So I think it's a great way that Shannon framed that and it peels back the curtain. You know what it does?
Well, it takes a routine conversation.
That's
and
what
turns
I was just
it,
say.
And turns it into something actually more interesting and more depth. It has there's more depth to it.
Yes.
Than this guy is the greatest because he won this many championships.
Correct.
End of conversation.
Correct.
Okay, but, you know, like who was harder to prepare for? Michael Jordan or LeBron James?
Yeah.
You know what I mean? If you put it that way, it's a little different conversation. And actually, you could make an argument. It's probably LeBron James than Michael Jordan, even though stopping the execution of Michael Jordan was damn near impossible. Preparing for all the things that LeBron James could do to you, especially now that he's evolved his game, it probably changes the conversation a little bit.
I don't know if I agree with that, but I also don't know if I want to get sucked into a LeBron MJ thing right here. You try to pull me in. I don't agree with that. Well, you know what?
You don't agree with it until you think about it.
No, I thought, as you were saying it, trust me, the wheels spin quickly, sometimes too quickly. I don't agree with that because there's so many different things we would have to incorporate into that conversation. Which era are we talking about? Which specific Bulls team and which specific LeBron team? It is too many things. Interesting thought. I disagree. I know why you would say that. I don't see it that way. It's not that different than, you know, I'm getting ready to play Game 7 of the World Series. Am I worried about what Joe Torre's going to do, or am I going to worry about Mariano on the opponent? Mariano coming into the ninth inning, throwing 95 under my hands with a cutter that's going to break my bat 7 out of 10 times where I have the one pitch and I still can't hit it. I'm worried about Mariano. I'm not worried about Joe Torre, even though Joe Torre's a Hall of Fame manager. So it's funny. When you actually think about it, it's not an incredibly unique way to look at it, but nobody really presents it that way, so it becomes unique, and it is very interesting. That's a good job by Shannon. I appreciate the honesty, too, with Dungy. You know, some people might try to sidestep that. No, he took you right down the list to say that, because some people will sensationalize that headline. You know, Dungy disses Brady. Dungy relegates Brady to peasant status. I mean, by the end of the day, you'll have him in the outhouse, you know?
Yeah. But he didn't even belong in the NFL, Tom Brady.
Exactly. Yeah, Tom Brady was lucky. Tom Brady's achievements were pure luck. He stumbled upon them. But he didn't just stop at Peyton. Like, he could have very easily said, hey, listen, Shannon, Peyton's my guy. There's no way in hell I'm getting on a podcast and saying that Peyton Manning's better than Tom Brady. Well, he took us deeper into the list. I mean, he threw out four. We thought it was five. Threw out four other names. And it's just very interesting context. I thought that was – I saw that. As soon as I saw that, I said, we're talking about that today.
Yeah. No, because there's an argument to say Tom isn't the hardest or the best or whatever you want to say. Everything
not
else,
even close. You mean the best player of all time or the hardest to prep for?
Well, the best, like the whatever the superlative is.
Yep.
For the quarterback, it seems like everybody ends a conversation with Tom Brady. This gives you a way to not end it with Tom, or at least cap it with Tom Brady.
The other interesting thing is that now, did he coach against them? I guess I don't.
He had to.
No, I'm bringing up a name we haven't mentioned yet. I don't think so. He didn't mention Montana, right? Which is interesting. Which is interesting because you think about.
I doubt it.
I don't think he did either. I'm saying no.
Tampa and he.
I was thinking as an assistant somewhere.
Maybe as an assistant early. You know, maybe definitely as an assistant early, but
early '90s Montana as an assistant early, but he doesn't have complete influence on the game plan. So, I think it's interesting in the aspect that the two GOATs, the two generally most widely positioned GOATs, forever it was Montana and now it's Brady. Neither would keep you up at night.
Yeah. By today's interpretation.
You'd be worried about Jerry Rice and Coach Walsh and his innovation.
Yeah. But by today's interpretation of quarterbacks,
they don't
keep you up at night.
That's true.
Like if Tony Dungy was asked this question 15 years ago or 20 years ago, he's probably still saying like a Joe Montana.
Thanks for watching. Make sure you like and subscribe. And don't forget to hit that bell to be notified when we drop fresh content.